Welcome all of you to the Foxy Medical Disorders in Pregnancy Committee TOG webinar. The topic today is congenital infections and anomalies. And today it's 11th July, India time. It's 6:30 in London. Weather is awesome and it's 2 p.m. And I would like to thank all of our sponsors, Aristo, Polynex Gold, IMX XT, and Foxy, and Science Integra to have this platform today on congenital infections and anomalies. I call upon our chairperson of Foxy Medical Disorders and Pregnancy Committee, Dr. Komal Chavan, to be live.
Thank you very much. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you to this webinar on recent advances in congenital infections and anomalies. And we have with us none other than the eminent stalwart speakers, Dr. Professor Dr. Asma Khalil from UK and our very own Dr. PK Shah, sir, who has been teacher and a guiding force in Foxy for all of us. And it is my great pleasure to hear from both the stalwarts, and we are going to have a real interesting and an informative webinar. And this will be moderated by Niranjan Chavan. And I thank and welcome all of you. And also like to thank Dr. Alpesh Gandhi, President Foxy, our sponsors Aristo and Team TOG Science Integra for making this platform possible. And I would not delay the proceedings because everybody is eagerly waiting to hear from Dr. Asma Khalil. So let me hand over to Dr. Niranjan Chavan, who is the moderator for today. And just a brief introduction of Dr. Niranjan Chavan. He's a professor and a unit chief at LTMMC, that is Sion Hospital, and a busiest medical college in the city of Mumbai. He's been a teacher for the last 22 years. He is vice president of the Mumbai Obstetrics and Gynec Society, secretary general of the Maharashtra chapter of IAG. He's also the national coordinator of the Foxy Medical Disorders in Pregnancy Committee. Over to you, Dr. Niranjan Chavan.
Thank you, Dr. Komal, for such a kind introduction. Now I would like to welcome Dr. Asma Khalil. I met her in 2015. What a young lady and a powerful lady she is. She presents her presentation with a lot of grace and elegance. And today, TOG webinar is bridging a lot of boundaries across the topics, across countries, and we have with us a very well-renowned professor in obstetrics, and she is working at the St. George Hospital, University of London, and her subspecialty is maternal and fetal medicine. She has published more than 200 peer-reviewed papers and has got a lot of prizes, a lot of articles in national and international journals and meeting. She is very, very passionate about fetal medicine. She's an inventor of the Hampton, an award-winning digital innovation which enables pregnant women to monitor their blood pressure. She is committed to the implementation of clinical guidelines in practice and believes that they could reduce inequalities in care across the NHS. She's an expert advisor of NICE. Her name resembles the sky, and so is her unlimited educational content. Asma is equal to sky. Asma, thank you, Dr. Asma. You have been kind enough to give us that honor and to be with us today. And I'm sure a lot of them are being eager to hear from you. Thank you so much. We'll be hearing today on congenital infections. And there are a lot of slides. I don't want to be in between you and the audience. But before that, I want to call the guru of gurus, great legend of fetal medicine, ultrasonography. I can say he's like a father of sonography in India. And I have witnessed it live for the last 25 years that he has taught innumerable and lakhs of students across India, across Pan India and the globe, none other than Dr. Paramananda Keshav Lal Shah. Very few of them know his middle name and the first name, but I am honored, and it's my grace and luck that I know that And sir, you have been a professor in Sion and KM Hospital. You have got innumerable accolades and positions. To name a few, you were the past president of FOXI, MOGS, IAG, and our All Medical Teachers Association at State GS Medical College. You also hold the office and the position of being a member of the FIGO Safe Motherhood Committee, and also you are a member of the Safe Motherhood and the Ultrasound Committee of AOFOG, and presently you are also the chairman of the Imaging Science Committee. Sir, if I can go and read your bio data, it is very lengthy, but thank you for being here. And you are going to talk something very, very different, which is related to fetal anomalies. So with that introduction of both of my eminent speakers, thank you all of you. Now I give the mic. Thank you, sir. And I give the mic to Asma Khalil, madam. And she is going to start her wonderful lecture. But before I give the mic, I want to say, sir, that your mustache has rolled up and COVID is very frightened of you. It is like Shivaji Maharaj, and students die to hear from you. But sir, we'll get back to you. We have Asma Khalil with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this. I have to say, this is the most passionate introduction I've ever had. So it's so nice. Thank you very much. And thank you for the kind invitation. It's a pleasure to be to be sort of joining this webinar and meeting my friends and colleagues online. So that's a COVID legacy, but it's very kind of you to invite me. Thank you. So I'm going to talk to you about congenital infections, and I'm just the reason why I'm talking about congenital infections and highlighting this ISWA guideline, which I was fortunate to lead on, which focused on the role of ultrasound in congenital infection. And this has very recently been published, literally is in the July issue of the Y Journal, Ultrasound Obstetrics and Gynecology. And I really invite you to, or encourage you to actually download it and read it. Well, first of all, what are the ultrasound signs? And it's important to go through that, because majority of the countries or doctors don't routinely screen for congenital infections during the pregnancy. And therefore, most of the cases are diagnosed or detected when we find ultrasound abnormalities that triggers us to actually test for congenital infections. And therefore, we all need to be aware of what are the ultrasound signs that are suggestive for congenital infection, or if we come across them ultrasound scan, that actually should make us test the mother or the fetus for possible congenital infections. And this can be grouped or categorized into three. So cranial abnormalities or brain abnormalities, extracranial abnormalities, and also the abnormalities, for example, of the placenta or the amniotic fluid. So what are the cranial abnormalities? Well, obviously the commonest, the one that we detect on ultrasound scan, is ventriculomegaly. Even if it's mild, ventriculomegaly can be associated with congenital infections. Mm-hmm. And I've put here some ultrasound images to show that. Calcification, for example, that you can see here on ultrasound. Intraventricular synechia or adhesions that you see inside the ventricles, that, like what you see on the ultrasound image on the bottom right corner of the screen. Or cerebellar abnormalities, like vermin have a place here, for example. Or periventricular pseudocyst, or cortical malformation, like lissencephaly or schizencephaly or polymicrogyria. But also microcephaly, so just a small head, that also could be a sign of congenital infection, like, for example, congenital cytomegalovirus infection, and therefore that should trigger you to test for congenital infection. The extracranial abnormalities would include things like ascites, pericardial effusion, skin edema, so the hydrops, or signs of fetal anemia that are not explained by maternal atypical antibodies. And also, if you have a small for gestational age or a small baby, or if you see hyperechogenic bowel that you can see in the ultrasound image here, or hepatomegaly or splenomegaly. So the definition of hepatomegaly is that when you have the length of the The liver is more than 4 centimeter, splenomegaly more than 3 centimeter, or if you have liver or disseminated calcification. Other abnormalities, so the third group was abnormalities of the placenta or the amniotic fluid, so placentomegaly or sick placenta more than 4 centimeter in diameter or thickness, or that there's oligohydramnios or polyhydramnios, or placental disseminated placenta calcification. So these ultrasound findings, if you come across it, think of congenital infections. The other thing that also the clinicians or the doctors need to be aware of potential scenarios or clinical scenarios that should trigger you or should make you think to test for particular infections. So for example, if the mother or the pregnant woman experienced non-vesicular rash or symptoms of systemic viral infection, think of rubella or parvovirus. If she have a facial rash, particularly the one that slap cheek syndrome, which is obviously characteristic or suggestive of parvovirus, or if the woman gives a history of significant exposure to viral illness, for example, she was in contact with a child or her son or daughter's friend that was diagnosed with chickenpox, for example, or she had a history of recent travel to places where there is outbreak or epidemic or things like Zika, for example. In this case, you test the serology for the particular infection. So I'm going to go through some individual infections. Obviously, the commonest is congenital CMV, which is the most frequent cause of congenital viral infection. It's present in the prevalence is about 0.2 to 2, so roughly 1 to 2% of all live births. And it is a leading infectious cause of sensory neural healing loss and mental retardation. Therefore, it's an important infection, congenital infection that we are aware of. The transmission, the vertical transmission, so the from the mother to the fetus is about roughly 30 to 40%, but it varies so much depending whether it's a primary CMV infection or secondary. So the primary it's called about 30 to 50%, while if it's secondary is only about 2 to 3%. Some people would argue and say, well, that's maybe one of the reasons why we don't routinely screen for CMV infection, because people say, well, 90% of the fetuses that have congenital CMV are asymptomatic at birth and don't necessarily have problems. But on the other hand, actually 10% of those are symptomatic at birth. And in those 10%, in this babies, the mortality risk is high, and 90% of them will develop complications. Of those 90% that were asymptomatic at birth, 10 to 15% of them will actually develop become symptomatic or develop complication later in life, mainly sensory neural hearing loss. How do we diagnose the fetal infection? It's by amniocentesis and testing for PCR, but we're going to go through that in more detail. And as I mentioned earlier, routine screening is not recommended in most countries for a number of reasons that we're not going to go through in this talk because of the time. But as I mentioned, the reason why I started my talk with showing you the possible ultrasound abnormalities that can be associated with congenital infection, because often it's the one that actually you see on the ultrasound scan and it's incidental finding, and then that makes you, triggers you to test and then diagnose that the mother had CMV infection or the fetus have CMV infection. If you look at all pregnant women, about 20 to 60% of them are susceptible. They've never been exposed to CMV infection before. And the reason why it's a range 20 to 60% is because it varies. So in the UK, for example, it varies so much according to the background and ethnic variation and socioeconomic class and so on. So there is variation in the prevalence of seroprevalence of CMV. So in those who are susceptible during the pregnancy, about 1 to 4% of them will actually seroconvert. So they will get exposed to primary CMV infection. And of those who get primary CMV infection, 40 to 50% of them will transmit. So the virus will cross from the mother to the fetus. And of those, about a third of them have symptoms at birth. Okay, what about the 40 to 80% of them who actually had CMV infection before, and therefore there are to some extent immune? About 0.5% of them actually have infants with congenital infection, which means congenital CMV infection, because either they have secondary infection, for example, or reactivation of the CMV. And in those fetuses, about less than 10% of them actually have symptoms at birth or at sequelae later in life. And therefore, the ISWAC, when we wrote the ISWAC guidelines, we have a number of recommendations based on evidence, and also we graded this evidence, we graded the recommendation based on evidence. So how to diagnose primary CMV infection in pregnant women is in two possible scenarios. Either you, this woman never had CMV IgG before and became a CMV IgG positive, so she seroconverted. Or if you detect CMV IgM antibodies and the IgG avidity is low. So IgG avidity is almost an indicator of the maturity of the, how mature is IgG antibody. And to some extent, if it is less than 30%, that suggests recent infection within the last 3 months. Okay, so that's a maternal primary CMV infection. What about actually secondary or non-primary CMV infection? And it's really impossible to be able to exclude it using serological tests or relying on the antibodies or the maternal serology. It's very difficult, and often we end up by doing an amniocentesis to rule out congenital CMV infection in these cases. I'm going to show you some cases, and this is so that often like the typical scenario of you coming across or diagnosing congenital CMV. So this woman was first pregnancy, had a first trimester ultrasound scan, was normal, low risk for Down syndrome, had no history of fever or systemic viral illness. She came for her second ultrasound scan at 20 weeks, and this was ultrasound findings, so small head, liver calcification, ventriculomegaly. You see this, you can see some ultrasound images there, small cerebellum. Obviously, that sort of made us think that there's actually congenital CMV, had amniocentesis, CMV PCR is positive, and she opted for termination in view of the, obviously, guarded prognosis or high risk of disability. Another patient, so this was her second pregnancy. First trimester, again, ultrasound scan is normal. The second trimester ultrasound scan was also normal. No history of fever, majority have history of fever or systemic viral illness. And then she had ultrasound scan at 29 weeks. And again, you see the ultrasound images, ventriculomegaly. There is a germinalysis cyst. The corpus callosum you can see here is abnormal. And there is lissencephaly, very smooth brain for that stage in pregnancy, and there's wide subarachnoid space. Again, had amniocentesis, CMV PCR is normal, and eventually she had termination. In fact, she had also MRI at 32 weeks, and this is MRI, ventriculomegaly, see the wide ventricular spaces, and also a smooth brain for that stage in pregnancy, and there was corpus callosum agenesis. So she had termination. And so back again to the guideline, how do we actually diagnose congenital or fetal CMV infection? With the only way to diagnose is by doing an amniocentesis and sending the amniotic fluid for CMV PCR. Okay, it's really important that you time the amniocentesis right to avoid the possibility of false negative result. So it's important that the amniocentesis, you wait until 8 weeks from the maternal infection, and that's not always very easy to define exactly when the maternal infection. But it's also important that you ideally delay it after 20 weeks until the fetal urine is well established, because you're looking for the CMV excreted through the kidney in the urine and then for an amniotic fluid. And in fact, if you look at the studies, you found that the most significant risk factor of false negative result on the amniocentesis is the fact that actually we have not really timed the amniocentesis correctly. So we haven't waited enough, like 8 weeks, or we've done the amniocentesis too early. Once you make the diagnosis of a congenital CMV or fetal CMV infection, the next important step is the prognosis, to actually decide or to determine what is the chance of the baby being affected, what is the chance of the baby being harmed by the CMV or the potential fetal damage, because remember, 90% of them are asymptomatic at birth. And there are three important factors to consider: is the timing of the infection, of the maternal infection, the presence, not just the presence, but also the type of fetal abnormalities, and laboratory parameters. So let's start with the gestational age at maternal infection. Well, the general rule is that if you have infection as the gestation advances, the chance of maternal fetal transmission is increased, but actually the chance of the fetal or fetal damage is lower. I'm just going to show you some of these figures. If you look at the gestational age of maternal infection and the risk of vertical transmission, the baby being infected. And you see here, so preconception, 15%, periconception, the first trimester, 30%, second trimester, 35%, and third trimester, 65%. So you can see clearly, as the gestation advances, the risk of fetal transmission increases. What about the actually the chance of severe symptoms at birth, so the actually the baby being harmed or fetal affection, is that goes in the opposite direction. So if the infection occurs early, primary maternal infection, preconception or the first trimester, the chance of severe symptoms at birth is higher compared to if it happens in the third trimester. And in fact, some recent studies suggest that actually it's mainly really the problem if it happens in the first trimester. And the fact that the chance of severe symptoms at birth if the maternal infection happened occurred after the first trimester is small, but excluding the chance of hearing loss. And the next, obviously, item is the fetal abnormalities. And the fetal abnormalities, I said it depends on also the type of abnormalities and obviously particularly the brain abnormalities. And again, if you look at the studies and you summarize the evidence, you find that actually if you have a normal ultrasound scan and normal fetal brain MRI throughout the pregnancy, the fact that the chance of the infant disability is actually low, but not indicative of hearing outcomes. And therefore, if you exclude the problem of hearing loss, if you have an ultrasound and an MRI that's completely normal and there's no brain abnormalities until the end of the pregnancy, the chance of infant disability is very, very low. And the other thing is that what we need to be aware of is that sometimes these brain abnormalities do not appear until several weeks, up to maybe even 12 weeks or even longer after maternal infection. And therefore, we need to keep doing detailed ultrasound scan and follow up for the remainder of the pregnancy. So it's not the fact that, you know, 20 weeks, you made the diagnosis and you look at the ultrasound scan and it's fine and say it's okay, there's no problem because there's no ultrasound abnormalities. You have to continue following up this pregnancy and repeating the ultrasound scan until the end of the pregnancy, looking for detailed ultrasound scan, looking for abnormalities, because they can appear later. What about the laboratory parameters? So we know that there are certain parameters that are associated with the risk of disability, such as, for example, the viral load in the amniotic fluid, the viral load in the fetal blood, the platelet count, liver enzymes. So that's true, and the studies have reported association. However, there is the degree of overlap between the one that actually have poor outcome and the one that had good outcomes is significant. And therefore, if you compare the prognostic value of these lab parameters compared to, for example, the finding of significant brain abnormalities, it have less prognostic value. And other markers, as like the platelet count, and there are some new markers like the beta-2 microglobulin. Again, they are associated, but I don't think they have very high predictive accuracy or prognostic value. And therefore, I think that the suggestion is that when you evaluate, so the baby is infected, you can categorize them or group them into one of the three groups. The one on the right-hand side is severe. So you have severe, significant brain abnormalities like for example, cortical abnormalities, listening carefully and so on. That's a poor prognosis, outcomes guarded, and therefore you can offer termination of the pregnancy depending on where you work and whether the law permits or not. The other one, the one green, the asymptomatic. So he actually did a detailed ultrasound scan, he did the MRI, everything is normal, he even did a fetal blood sample, everything is okay, and therefore the prognosis is generally good, and in this case, we reassure the parents. However, you warn them that you cannot predict or exclude the risk of hearing loss. And then the one in orange or yellow, the one in the middle, which is a mild or moderate, and this group of fetuses, there may be some abnormalities, fetal abnormalities, but they're not significant brain abnormalities, maybe hyperechogenic bowel or mild ventricular megaly or isolated calcification, or maybe there's no ultrasound abnormalities on the scan, but there may be some laboratory markers. And therefore, this group of fetuses, it's difficult because there is a risk, but it's difficult to quantify. The risk is not very high. And in this is the group of fetuses that people have tried to give antiviral treatment or to offer antenatal intervention. And I'm going to go through that in detail. And to which antiviral or what things that we can or people have tried to give is the valacyclovir, which is the prodrug of the acyclovir, which we're all familiar with because the one that we use for herpes simplex virus. And this study, for example, initially tried to do a randomized control trial of giving oral valacyclovir versus placebo, but it was difficult because people did not want to be randomized. And therefore, they couldn't do it as a randomized control trial, ended up by doing almost comparing the group of women who received the valacyclovir versus historical group of pregnant women who had the CMV but did not have any treatment. And the importance or significance of this study, which was published in an American journal a few years back, the fact that they actually reported that they're giving the valacyclovir during pregnancy to this woman or reduces the chance of symptomatic or actually increases the chance of asymptomatic neonates from about 40% to 80%, which is, you know, potentially a good result. It's important to know that this actually, they're giving high dose of valacyclovir, 8 gram per day, that's about 16 tablets, much higher dose than what we give, for example, for herpes simplex. The other thing, if you see which fetuses, which pregnancy they give, if you see this was the criteria that they used in this study, or which is almost the same group as the mild or moderate infected fetuses, the one I showed you in the previous slide in the middle. So either some mild abnormalities or some isolated lab abnormalities. But the problem, because it was a randomized controlled trial, certainly all the guidelines did say, well, that looks promising, but it's not really a randomized controlled trial, and therefore we don't necessarily, they don't recommend that should be part of the routine practice. What was really, I think, useful about the study is that it provided reassuring safety data on the use of valacyclovir, particularly in this high dose of 8 gram per day in pregnancy. And they collected the maternal clinical and lab tolerance sort of symptoms and data, and there was no adverse neonatal outcomes. And therefore, it provided safety data to give this drug. But as I mentioned earlier, certainly the guidelines, whether it's work or the RSUG, did say there was not a randomized controlled trial, and therefore giving high dose valacyclovir for congenital CMV infection, something that we have to be either in the context of research or very cautiously. The other thing that people tried is the immunoglobulin, and certainly the initial observational studies from Italy were very promising. However, when it was actually when they conducted the randomized controlled trial, unfortunately, there was no evidence of effectiveness or the fact that actually giving immunoglobulin is useful. And if anything, there was a potential harm, the increased risk of preterm birth. And therefore, definitely it's not recommended. And this is a really useful flowchart, and it's included in the ISWA guideline. I'm just going to take you through it. So if you made the diagnosis, so there is now fetal infection, you've done the amniocentesis, you made sure that you've done it correctly at the time and you didn't do it too early to avoid the false negative result. Once you make the diagnosis of congenital CMV infection, the next step is to do target ultrasound examination, ideally by fetal medicine specialist, every 2 to 4 weeks. Because you're looking for specific abnormalities, and offering MRI, or considering doing MRI 28 to 32 weeks. And again, if the MRI is normal, repeat it later, maybe a month later during pregnancy, and you might or might not consider doing fetal blood sample. And then you group this baby or categorize it into 3. So severely symptomatic, lots of abnormalities. In this case, you offer termination. If you do, it's important to send the placenta examination and offer postmortem examination. If it's asymptomatic fetus and everything is okay, you expect the management until delivery. At the delivery, again, you send the placenta for examination, and then assessment of the baby at birth with a clinical examination, hearing test, eye examination, laboratory for signs of, obviously, for the CMV infection or potential damage, imaging, so prenatal ultrasound scan or MRI. Because the babies who are symptomatic or have any signs at birth, In this case, we do offer them postnatal treatment using GAN acyclovir, and there is plenty of data on effectiveness of GAN acyclovir from randomized controlled trial. They only give it symptomatic fetuses because actually GAN acyclovir itself is potentially dangerous antiviral drug. And obviously these babies will have long-term follow-up. Okay, what about the group in the middle? So mild to moderate symptomatic. In this case, you could consider the initial treatment using valacyclovir and follow up the pregnancy. And again, you will either see abnormalities and poor prognosis, you consider offering optional termination, or there's no abnormalities and things are stable, expect the management until delivery. And can we prevent a CMV infection? And the answer is potentially yes, because certainly there is evidence that behavior modification aiming at reducing the risk of maternal infection in the first place, that actually could potentially be useful. And it's as you know, CMV is transmitted through body fluids, so mainly saliva and urine. And certainly that the common scenario would be that the mother who had the previous child, maybe age 3 or so, that actually she gets infection from the older child. And therefore, the general advice is that we, obviously the hygiene, you know, washing hands, avoid sharing things with young children, avoid kissing the children directly on the lips and so on. I think it's really important, and it's probably our responsibility as healthcare professionals, to educate pregnant women about the CMV, about the implication of potential harm of CMV, and also about how to reduce the risk of actually getting CMV infection during the pregnancy. And the other thing, which is quite new, and this that has been presented in conference, I have not seen it being published yet, but this is potentially very, very important data. This was a randomized controlled trial in Israel, where they actually gave valacyclovir at the same dose that I showed you before, so 8 grams per day of valacyclovir, to women who had a transmission, or so they had infection early in pregnancy, so it is either preconception in the first trimester, to reduce the risk of vertical transmission or mother to child transmission, or mother to fetus transmission. So they randomized, the woman randomized in the first trimester following the fact that they had seroconverted. And they included about 100 women, 45 had the valacyclovir, 45 had placebo, and they looked at the risk of vertical transmission. So they do amniocentesis at 20 weeks. And you see this is the results. This is brilliant. So the outcome, which is like positive amniocentesis, for example, 11% in the one that had the valacyclovir versus 30% in the one that had placebo. So obviously 70% reduction in the risk of transmission. So, you know, this is a brilliant results, and that potentially should influence our management. Moving on to another infection, toxoplasma. And again, the mother-to-child transmission is about 30%. And again, consistent with the rule that the fact that transmission increases with gestation, but actually the severity of the infection is reduced as the pregnancy advances. And again, this table shows you this. So if you see the gestation age at maternal seroconversion, if this is the risk of infection, congenital infection, so the transmission, and this is the risk of the actually symptomatic infection. So you can see here at early gestation, as the gestation advances, the risk of congenital infection is higher. So the virus or the toxoplasma can cross the placenta from the mother to the fetus. However, it's the risk of the baby being affected or having a symptomatic infection is actually lower. But it's important to know that 95% of those who will have toxoplasma, they will actually have normal development. About 4% of them will have harm, and the harm could include perinatal death or permanent neurological damage and visual impairment, because toxoplasma can cause chorioretinitis and a problem that even can develop after birth during the first years of life. So it can sometimes not be obvious at birth. So how to diagnose maternal toxoplasma infection? And it's quite tricky. And the general rule in congenital infections, at least for me, is that the IgM antibodies sometimes is difficult to interpret, and the results can be confusing. And therefore, I often involve my colleagues as a multidisciplinary team, whether the virologist or the microbiologist or the infectious specialist, and it's important to involve them in the interpretation of the serology findings. So if you have positive or equivocal IgM with a negative IgG, you need to send a new specimen, a new sample for IgG and IgM in about 2 weeks. If the result is the same, this IgM result is probably a false positive. So be careful of potentially false positive result of the IgM antibodies. Again, if you have equivocal result of one antibody and positive with the other, again, you need to send us another sample in 2 weeks. And again, sometimes we send it to the reference lab to be able to interpret the results and tell us what, you know, is this a mother had infection during the pregnancy or not. It also is important to know that if you have a high IgG avidity in the first 12, 16 weeks, so in the first trimester, for example, that suggests that the mother had infection before the pregnancy. Remember, high IgG avidity suggested infection occurred more than 3 months before that. And as I mentioned, it's important to have a reference lab or include a specialist while you interpret inconclusive or difficult serology results. How do you diagnose fetal toxoplasma infection? Similar to fetal CMV infection, you need to have an amniotic fluid sample. So you do amniocentesis and send the sample to the lab. And again, you need to make sure that you time it right to avoid the possibility of false negative result. It's important to know that there is a small chance of false negative result, but certainly the new assays suggest that it's more accurate than that. What about treatment? Can we do something to reduce the risk of fetal infection? And certainly, often we would consider giving spiromycin 1 gram 3 times a day to prevent vertical transmission of toxoplasma. And it's important that you start the toxoplasma treatment soon, so about within 3 weeks from maternal seroconversion. Okay, once you make the diagnosis, you've done the amniocentesis and you did confirm that there is toxoplasma or fetal toxoplasma infection, spiromycin is not enough, and therefore you need to start this regime, which is alternating regime of spiromycin only for 1 week, followed by pyrimethamine plus sulfadiazine plus folic acid for 1 week. This French multi-center randomized trial actually tested or randomized this woman with toxoplasma infection to either spiromycin on its own or a combination of pyrimethamine, sulfadiazine, and folic acid to see whether actually the combination is more effective in reducing the risk of vertical transmission. And the result, they couldn't recruit, so they had to stop early, but certainly the data suggests that actually doing the combination regime is better than just giving spiromycin on its own. So promising, however, again, for the guidelines, and they said they wanted more data because they said that this was not a conclusive trial. Okay, once you make the diagnosis of fetal infection, you need to follow up and do ultrasound scan looking for signs of fetal affection, so the difference between infection and infection. And that means you're looking at the brain, because of brain abnormalities, meaning looking at the eyes, and doing growth assessment because it can cause growth restriction on small babies. So scan every 4 weeks. And also it is important that we warn the parents about the possibility of long-term sequelae, about 30%, and the fact that the chorioretinitis caused by the toxoplasma can cause vision loss, which can actually happen after birth. This is a case that I came across and like to share with you. This lady was 34 years old, had a previous uncomplicated low-risk pregnancy, singleton. This pregnancy, she was 31 weeks plus 4 days, and she had spontaneous dicornate diameter twin. And she was referred to us at about 31 weeks because one of the twins had severe bilateral ventricular megaly. And you can see this is an ultrasound image. You see this is severe ventricular megaly, and the other twin was normal. Of course, we did the TOG, the maternal sample, to test for infections, NAT for the platelet antibodies, and also offered amniocentesis. This is on the second twin, which is ultrasound scan, which was normal. We also did an MRI, which confirmed that there was severe ventriculomegaly in one twin, and the other twin had no brain abnormalities. When we did the maternal serology, came back as positive for toxoplasma, both IgM and IgG. We did double amniocentesis, and the amniotic fluid came back as positive for toxoplasma toxoplasma DNA, and that was positive in both babies. And it's interesting, and as a learning point here, is the fact that sometimes in twin pregnancy, both babies can be infected, but actually their reaction or affection or being harmed by the infection can vary between the two twins. So once the diagnosis was made, and of course you have severe ductomegaly, that was advice about the treatment, so sulfadiazine, pyrimethamine, and folonic acid, and you do this as a rotation between this combination regime and with spiromycin. And obviously at birth, you still need to continue the treatment and of course do the assessment at birth, both clinically and serologically, and also do an eye examination, send the placenta for PCR, and blood sample from the baby, and the baby should have obviously follow-up. So the woman came back at 35 weeks and ventriculomegaly was worse, 32 weeks. Meantime, she considered her option and she came asking for selective termination of the fixed fetus with severe ventriculomegaly. So she had this procedure and 2 days later she came presented feeling unwell. But her blood pressure was normal. We did her blood test and her blood test had high urea, 13.4, high creatinine, PCR 74 and CRP is 22. So not preeclampsia, blood pressure is completely normal, but she's definitely feeling unwell. Next day, this is where her blood is getting worse. So the urea is going up, the creatinine is going up, and CRP is going up. So we're not really sure what's going on, but certainly she had acute kidney injury stage 1. And after thought and discussions with a nephrologist, this woman had acute interstitial nephritis secondary to sulfadiazine. And therefore, it's important for us to realize when we give sulfadiazine to a pregnant woman, we need to know the possibility of reaction, which is acute interstitial nephritis. So because she was already 35 weeks, and the fact that we, you know, the baby or the surviving twin needed to continue on this treatment, in this case, we decided to deliver the mother so we can stop maternal treatment, and we would deliver the baby. We can actually treat the baby after birth. So she had the C-section, healthy female child, 0.6 kilo. And this was the blood test, repeat blood test, both natally. And you can see that actually the urea and the creatinine gradually come back to normal, and she was discharged on day 9. And the maternal renal function went back to normal after stopping the sulfadiazine. So it's an interesting case, and there's several learning points here. Okay, moving on to the parvovirus B19, how we make the diagnosis and how we manage this pregnancy. So it's important that we are familiar with, obviously, the classic rash of slap cheek. And obviously, another presentation if the woman presents with a hydropic fetus on ultrasound scan or fetal anemia on ultrasound scan. We'll always think of the possibility of parvovirus B19, and you can check for serology. And the other thing, again, IgM sometimes is difficult, can be confusing. It can, there's a possibility of false negative result. How we diagnose fetal parvovirus B19, we can actually do amniocentesis and look for the viral DNA in amniotic fluid. However, we often do it only if we're going to do invasive testing. So we don't just do amniocentesis for the sake of the diagnosis of the parvovirus. We will do it if we need to do fetal intervention, for example, in the form of cordocentesis, because the baby's anemic and we need to do intrauterine transfusion. Once we make the diagnosis, we need to monitor this fetus by ultrasound scan. And the monitoring should start 4 weeks from the maternal infection or the seroconversion. You need to carry on up to 12 weeks after that. And the scan frequency should be every 1 to 2 weeks. And we're looking for signs of anemia, like what you see here, high drops, pericardial effusion, cardiomegaly, asthmatosis. So these are the things that we look for in ultrasound scan. And of course, the fetal anemia, we look for the Doppler, the middle subarachnoid peak systolic velocity, because it will be abnormal even before the development of the high drops. When you suspect fetal anemia, so you have the peak systolic velocities above 1.5 mm, or there is ascites or high drops, in this case, obviously, you arrange for urgent blood transfusion. What's the prognosis of the baby? Well, it depends whether the baby is hydropic or not. If the baby is hydropic, the perinatal death is up to 30%, compared to only 6% if the fetus is not hydropic. And there's some that suggest that when the baby is hydropic, there is 10% risk of neurodevelopmental abnormalities later in life. Moving on to another infection, which is the rubella. And it is true that actually seeing rubella infection during pregnancy or congenital rubella syndrome is rare nowadays. And that's why I think we need to be aware of the, the possible rash. And also be aware that there is a chance of false positive result if you look at the IgM antibodies. As I mentioned, the IgM is be careful because it can be confusing and its interpretation is sometimes can be difficult. If you have a primary infection before in the first trimester, so in 12 weeks, because of the possibility of congenital rubella syndrome, which obviously have significant severe abnormalities, in this case, it's reasonable to offer or consider the option of termination of the pregnancy even without invasive testing. How we diagnose a fetal infection, again, the same with amniocentesis, and you make sure you time it, you don't do it too early to avoid the possibility of false negative result. So what's congenital rubella syndrome? So again, you could have a cataract, and you see here the lenses are really echogenic. You can have microphthalmia, and therefore, be careful. You could also have heart abnormalities. And varicella zoster virus or chickenpox. Often the scenario that this pregnant woman had exposure. So she came across her own son or daughter, developed chickenpox, or actually one of their friends had chickenpox. And the question here is that whether they, number one, whether she's immune or not, and number two, whether there was a significant contact or not. Well, immune or not, you can test, particularly if there's a booking sample, we can test if she had antibodies or she has been exposed before or not. And the other thing, how do you define significant contact? And the definition is face-to-face contact for 5 minutes or being in the same room for 15 minutes or more. And how do we actually counsel about the risk? And it's the same, it depends on the gestational age. So if the timing of maternal infection, if early, for example, in the first trimester, the chance of congenital varicella syndrome is less, sort of changes obviously with gestation. And therefore, if it happens between 13 and 20 weeks, 2% after 20 weeks is minimal. But certainly in the third trimester after 36 weeks, there's a high 25% chance, but it's neonatal varicella. What about if the woman have herpes zoster? So it's not like a chicken box. So she shingles, which is sort of almost a recurrence or herpes zoster, which is the lesions. And she, particularly if she had chicken box before, in this case, we should be reassured that the chance of the fetal or perinatal harm is very, very low. So what is congenital varicella syndrome? It can have a number of ultrasound features. Microphthalmia can have limb deformities. We can have high drops or growth restriction, can have disseminated calcifications and also ventriculomegaly. And therefore, the main sort of concern is that if it happens in the first 20 weeks, after 20 weeks, I think the risk is very small. And therefore, if it happens, we do serial ultrasound scan monitoring for the signs of congenital varicella syndrome. Is this a treatment or prophylaxis or an intervention to reduce the risk? Well, if you have an exposure, a history of significant exposure to varicella or shingles, and if the pregnant woman is found not to be immune, in this case, we offer or we give the VZIC or the varicella zoster immunoglobulin within 10 days after exposure. Last year, certainly there has been a shortage of the varicella zoster immunoglobulin, and therefore in the UK there has been updated guidance or change in practice where actually we give the acyclovir instead of the VZEC as a post-exposure prophylaxis. And also if the woman developed varicella, so if she starts developing the symptoms or the rash, we need to start the oral acyclovir within 24 hours of developing the rash. And of course, if there is a possibility of fetal varicella syndrome, certainly if the maternal infection in the first 20 weeks, there is option of termination if according to the law where you work. The last infection, which I'm not going to go through in detail, obviously is a congenital Zika. And it was certainly in 2016 when there was the epidemic. It was a big problem because it is phytotoxic, and certainly it's been cases of fetal damage and microcephaly, particularly in South America, secondary to Zika infection. I'm just going to highlight that there is work at that time. They published interim guidance on what ultrasound findings of Zika virus infection in pregnancy, and there is no treatment, and so far I'm not aware of any treatment, but certainly the epidemic is over and it's no longer a major concern, and therefore I'm not going to spend time on it. So I'm going to stop here, and I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Asma. It was a wonderful lecture. You covered CMV, rubella, parvo, Zika, cytomegalo, varicella, and coronavirus is remaining. But we will discuss that later.
But coronavirus is, until now, is not really classified as congenital infection.
Because that's very good news, madam.
Yes, because actually the risk of it's still very controversial whether actually really the coronavirus does cross the placenta and causes fetal infection or not. And therefore, in fact, we actually even consider it in the ISWA guideline, whether do we need to include the coronavirus infection or not. And we felt that it's not really considered as a congenital infection, and therefore we didn't include it.
Absolutely. We will keep that discussion in the month of August when we meet again, madam, with one more lecture of yours. We are not going to leave you.
I'm not going anywhere.
So thank you so much, and we will come back, madam. And I request now Dr. P.K. Shah, sir, to please start his lecture on fetal anomalies and the role of methyl folate in pregnancy. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Niranjan. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good. So I thank Foxy and all the organizers, and especially Aristo, for giving me this opportunity to talk to you all on fetal anomalies and role of L-methyl folate. Thank you, Niranjan. Thank you, Komal, for involving me. This is something which I think I'm talking on for the first time in my life. A very interesting subject, fetal anomalies. We already seen beautiful ultrasound pictures when Professor Asma was talking. I'm not going to show those. But when you talk about fetal anomalies, there is an estimated 2,76,000 babies die within 4 weeks of birth every year worldwide from congenital anomalies. Congenital and fetal anomalies include structural as well as functional anomalies like metabolic disorders that occur during intrauterine life and can be identified prenatally at birth or later in life. Despite the widespread use of prenatal ultrasound, only 44 to 74% of anomalies are diagnosed before birth. What about India? And what is the prevalence? In India, birth defects prevalence varies from 61 to almost 70% per 1,000 live births. Congenital anomalies account for 8 to 15% of perinatal deaths and 13 to 16% of neonatal deaths in our country. And these include congenital heart defects, neural tube defects, Down syndrome, hemoglobinopathies, glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency, and they cause almost 20% of infant mortality. To tell you about groups of fetal anomalies in central nervous system, anencephaly, porencephaly, encephalocele, Dandy Walker, craniofacial cleft, lip palate, hemifacial microsomia, in-neck, goiter, hygroma, chest, bronchopulmonary sequestration, stable CCAM, pulmonary agenesis, in cardiac AST, VST, AV canal defect, cardiomyopathy, and in abdominal wall defects, body stock anomalies, bladder, etc. If you have to divide these anomalies etiologically, then 30 to 40% are genetic, 5 to 10% are environmental, and 60% are multifactorial. Genetics include like Down syndrome, environmental infectious diseases, maternal diseases, teratogenic drugs, alcohol, smoking, environmental pollutants, all these can cause congenital anomalies. And the biggest group, that is complex multifactorial origin caused by gene-environmental interaction, when so-called polygenic liability predisposition is triggered by environmental risk factors like isolated neural tube defect, orofacial clefts, cardiovascular malformations, etc. What are the factors influencing occurrence of fetal anomalies? First is the maternal age at conception, proportion of unplanned pregnancies and no antenatal care, medical condition and nutritional status of the mother, rate of consanguineous marriages in the population, parents' carrier status of a genetic disorder, and exposure to teratogens. Every baby deserves a healthy start, and that is why maternal nutrition is very vital for programming health care. What is the maternal nutrition status? At no other time in women's life is nutrition so important before, during, and after pregnancy. Preconception nutrient needs, pregnancy increase nutrient demands, and lactation also increases nutrient needs. What about situation as regards micronutrient deficiency in our country? The silent hunger, as it is called. 41.6% pregnant women in India had folic acid deficiency, with serum folic acid level less than 3 nanogram per milliliter. 65% of mothers had low plasma vitamin concentration, 35% had elevated plasma total homocysteine concentration more than 10. So micronutrients are the key factors for sustaining new life, and that includes folic acid and the active factor, that is L-methylfolate, vitamin B12 and vitamin B6. What is the role of folate, vitamin B12 and vitamin B6 in pregnancy? Preconception in first trimester for prevention of neural tube defect and congenital anomalies. Second and third trimester, growth and development of the fetus. It reduces hyperhomocysteinemia and related complications, decreases risk of preterm birth, preeclampsia, and placental abruption, and prevents anemia. And in postpartum and lactation, the growth and development of fetus and prevents anemia in mother who is on breastfeeding. What is the importance of folic acid as far as DNA synthesis and cell division is concerned? The folic acid is required for the synthesis of nucleotides, urines, and thymine, which are the building blocks for the DNA. Folic acid metabolism includes DNA biosynthesis, methylation reaction, and regulation of homocysteine levels. Folic acid, vitamin B12, and vitamin B6 decrease homocysteine levels. What happens when there is a deficiency of vitamin B? Hypomethylation of DNA occurs, inhibition of DNA biosynthesis occurs, and there is hyperhomocysteinemia. Hyperhomocysteinemia-induced pregnancy complications include fetal complication and maternal complications, And in fetal complications, it includes congenital abnormalities like NTDs, cleft palate, stillbirth, lower birth weight, IUGR, preterm birth. And in maternal complications, preeclampsia, preterm labor, placental abruption, gestational hypertension, and recurrent pregnancy loss. Hyperhomocysteinemia is an independent causal factor for pregnancy complications. Hyperhomocysteinemia and maternal complications. There is a 7.7-fold risk for preeclampsia and recurrent pregnancy loss. Endothelial damage from hyperhomocysteinemia leads to venous thromboemboli and placental insufficiency, which can lead to recurrent pregnancy loss. Say 2 to 3 times risk for pregnancy-induced hypertension and abruption placenta because of hyperhomocysteinemia. So, in the fetus, hyperhomocysteinemia-induced fetal complications include neural tube defects, IUGR, congenital heart disease, and fetal death. So what are the factors that are causing hyperhomocysteinemia? One, genetic mutation. When you have methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase enzyme polymorphism is occurring, or when there is deficiency of vitamin B, B12, B6, and folic acid, that is L-methylfolate. What is the risk of pregnancy complication despite folic acid supplementation? This is very interesting. That you can have risk of pregnancy complications even if you give folic acid. Some women who take folic acid supplements during pregnancy preconception period still have offspring with NTDs and other pregnancy complications. What is the cause? The reason is that there is a defective metabolism due to methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase polymorphism. So alone by giving folic acid, vitamin B6 and B12 is not going to work. So you have to find out this particular deficiency. So genetic polymorphism in MTHFR gene, there is a polymorphism in gene coding for methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase hormone to reduce efficiency of folic acid metabolism. And polymorphisms increase risk of hyperhomocysteinemia and pregnancy complications. That is the link. When you have normal MTFR enzyme activity, you will have normal blood levels of folate and normal levels of homocysteine. If you have reduced MTHFR enzyme activity, less than 71% of normal, the minus 71% of normal, you will have reduced blood levels of folate and high levels of homocysteinemia. And if you have a greatly reduced MTHFR activity, minus 34% of normal, then you will have significantly lower levels of folate and significantly higher levels of homocysteine. Sorry. Now, what is the global prevalence of MTHFR polymorphism? The prevalence of MTHFR polymorphism is different geographical regions and ethnic groups. It varies from 20 to 50%. In India, the prevalence of MTHFR polymorphism is between 28 to 35%. What are the complications in fetus due to MTHFR polymorphism? This is evidence-based medicine, and I am showing you some of these publications. That MTHFR polymorphism detected in 19% of neural tube defect cases. And this paper, published in Pediatric Research in 2000, concluded that MTHFR polymorphism is the most established genetic risk factor for development of neural tube defects. Association of maternal MTHFR polymorphism with susceptibility to neural tube defect. This is one more paper from PLOS1, published in 2012, which also concluded similarly. MTHFR polymorphism increases the risk of congenital heart disease by almost 4.6 times, as shown in OBGYN journal 2010. MTHFR polymorphism, the risk factor for congenital heart defect, same thing again shown and published in European Heart Journal. What are the complications during pregnancy because of MTHFR polymorphism? It leads to hyperhomocysteinemia and it can cause recurrent pregnancy loss, as published in Journal of OBGYN 2003. It also can lead to placental abruption and IUGR, as published in American Journal of Medicine 2004. There is an association between MTHFR gene polymorphism and hypertension in pregnancy, and the pregnancy hypertension can go up by 1.2 times. There is a need for a bioactive triad to address hyperhomocysteinemia, and these includes folic acid, vitamin B12 and vitamin B6 in their active form. That means L-methylfolate, methylcobalamin and pyridoxal 5-phosphate respectively. L-methylfolate is a genetic nutrient to counter genetic polymorphism. When you give L-methylfolate, the active form of folic acid, it does not require any conversion. Why? Because when you give folic acid, it must complete a 4-step conversion process. So conversion of folic acid to L-methylfolate takes place in intestinal wall, RBCs, liver and dividing cells. Whereas when you give directly L-methylfolate, obviously you give the active form to the mother. Methylfolate is more effectively increases the RBC folate concentration, as you can see the blue line compared to red line. The blue line is methylfolate, whereas the red line is folic acid given in 400 microgram. L-methylfolate more effectively reduces the homocysteine levels. As you can see, the L-methylfolate does the reduction by 14.6%, whereas the folic acid will reduce it by only 9.3%. And hence, L-methylfolate is more effective than folic acid in lowering homocysteine, hyperhomocysteine concentration. It also significantly reduces the risk of NTDs. As you can see here, when you give placebo, obviously, number of cases are almost 34-35, but estimated decrease was zero. When you give folic acid 400 microgram, around 55%. And when you give L-methylfolate 416 microgram, the reduction was 66%. So L-methylfolate significantly decreases the risk of NTDs as compared to folic acid. The World Regulatory Authority have given recommendations as regards use of this. Bioavailability of folic acid and methylfolate is similar. Maximum protection occurs due to dose. It is dose-dependent reduction of NTDs with folic acid. That if you give 400 microgram, percentage prevention of NTD is 36%. You increase it to 1 milligram, it is 57%. You increase it to 4 milligram, the prevention of NTD is 82%. And if you give 5 milligram, it is reduction is by almost 85%. L-methylfolate dosage and administration, the dose is 5 milligram per day with or without food. And 5 milligram L-methylfolate is equivalent to 5 milligram of folic acid. Give 5 milligram of methylfolate once daily from preconception, that means 3 months before conception till lactation. A word or two about methylcobalamin, that is vitamin B12 and vitamin B6, because this is a triad that one must use. Methylcobalamin is the active form of vitamin B12. 65% of the mothers had low plasma vitamin B12 concentration, and 35% had elevated plasma total homocysteine concentration. Remember this. And you have an increased risk of NTDs and hyperhomocysteemia due to its role in homocysteine metabolism in conjugation with folic acid. So you have to give both. Then vitamin B6, pyridoxal 5-phosphate, the active form of vitamin B6. Vitamin B6 deficiency increases the risk of toxemia of pregnancy, as already I have told you. And the average concentration of P5P, that is pyridoxal 5-phosphate, the active form of B6, is there in the cord blood. Normal infants have 28.4 nanogram per milliliter, whereas the infants with preeclamptic women have half of it, that is 12.2 nanograms per milliliter. The brain development in infants of toxemic mothers may be retarded. Dietary supplementation with vitamin B6 should be instituted in women at higher risk of development of toxemia of pregnancy. So pyridoxal 5-phosphate reduces toxemia of pregnancy. When you give folate, L-methyl folate, vitamin B12 and B6 supplementation, there is a significant reduction in homocysteine level. As you can see in the red box, that in healthy preeclamptic, eclamptic placental absorption, you see it is from 14 to 19, and it is reduced to almost 9 to 11. So that is significant reduction. To summarize my talk, ladies and gentlemen, bioactive diet is required to decrease hyperhomocysteinemia, and folic acid, vitamin B12 and vitamin B6 should be given in their active form. Like L-methyl folate is a genetic nutrient. The bioactive form of folic acid, there is no conversion required unlike folic acid. It is unaffected by MTHFR polymorphism. More efficient homocysteine metabolism when you give it, and more efficient increased RBC folate concentration. Methylcobalamin, the bioactive form of vitamin B12 when you give, deficiency, methylcobalamin deficiency during pregnancy increases the risk of early pregnancy loss, preeclampsia, NTDs, and hence it is very vital that you give vitamin B12 about 100 microgram per day. Pyridoxal 5-phosphate, the bioactive form of pyridoxine, that is vitamin B6, is very important to be given so that you can reduce the cases of toxemia of pregnancy, again in 100 microgram per day. Every baby deserves a healthy start, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful lecture. And you have covered very nicely, sir, all the topics, all the points which are there, and I'm very grateful to you. Thank you so much, Asma madam, and you, Dr. PK Shah, sir. Thank you so much. There is a
thank voice.
Thank you, sir. There is a voice which is coming. I'll just shut it off. Actually, I was going in the meantime on internet, and I saw a study in Milan done in Italy, where they studied and presented in International AIDS Society conference, where 31 women were studied of coronavirus, and they found that out of which two women, the placenta was affected and there was transmission into the fetus. So that was a study which was there. I was just listening to that, and it is great to hear from both of you. There are questions which are lined up, sir. And I would like to come to Asma madam. Please come live and we can just take few questions. Dr. Asma, can you hear me? Thank you so much. Madam, we have got more than 1,500 viewers who have logged in. There was some issue in between while your lecture was going on and during, sirs, regarding the logging in of the viewers, but we have sorted it out. And I'm very happy to tell you, madam and sir, that both your lectures were really, really good. And there was a lot of, discussion at the back end, which were going on. And ultimately, now we have got all the viewers. And if some of them have missed it, we will be showing live recording by tomorrow. So there's nothing to be disheartened. So, madam, we come to you now. What are the long-term neurological complications in children which are born to women which are infected with CMV? You have already dealt that in the lecture, but there are other viewers who have joined later on. So we would like to know what are the long-term neurological complications in children which are born to women who have infected infection with CMV. Can you hear me, Dr. Asma?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Yes.
Okay, fantastic. And so you were asking about the long-term neurological complication of the fetuses with CMV. Okay. Yes. Well, I mean, obviously the commonest is sensory neural hearing loss. That's the commonest neurological problems. But certainly they could also vary from, you know, cerebral palsy, sort of the extreme cases, but also varying degrees of disability. Obviously, you know, so apart from the deafness, it could be blindness, it could be, varying degree of motor or sensory problems, neurological abnormalities. But as the commonest would be hearing loss.
Okay. One more question, madam. Before that, there was a comment from Dr. Asha Bakshi, and she has said, Dr. Asma, what a wonderful and excellent presentation you have done. Dr. Asha Bakshi is from Indore, and she is also the chairperson. She was the chairperson now. So that's what we would like to tell you, that people are really in awe of hearing your lecture.
Which is great. Thank you very much. I'm delighted that people actually find it useful. And as I said, like, I was fortunate to lead on the ISWOC guideline on congenital infection. So, and it's published in this month in this issue of the Y Journal. And therefore, you can download it free. And I'd like to also invite you to download it and read it.
Yes, I would like to tell the viewers that Dr. Asma is on Twitter. She's Professor Asma. You please search her and you can follow. She has got a lot of followers and she regularly updates her conferences, her lectures, and they are really nice to hear, and we get updates. So thank you, madam, for being there. One more question is there for you, then I'll go to Dr. PK Shah, sir. What is the importance of torch test in modern obstetrics in present scenario? And do you really continue to do it in your country? And how do you manage the torch cases who are positive?
Okay, so the question is about the torch. And as I said, we don't, in the UK, we don't routinely screen for torch. So not all pregnant women will have routinely torch. Torch is a blood, for those who don't know, I mean, it's a blood sample to check for toxoplasma, CMV, rubella, and so on. And in fact, even in the UK, we stopped even screening for rubella at booking. And therefore, the role of torch is mainly when you suspect that there is maybe infection. So you find an ultrasound, for example, echogenic bowel, ventricular megaly, IUGR, small baby. In this case, you would do maternal torch screen or blood sample for torch. And the other thing is that, for example, if the woman comes with rash or she comes with, you suspect that there may be maternal infection, in this case, we'll do a torch screen. And that's the only place really that we would do torch for nowadays.
Thank you, Dr. Asma. I will come back to you soon. Dr. PK Shah,
yes.
There are many, many excellent remarks for your presentation. There are people who are hearing from Jammu, Kashmir to Kanyakumari, from Mumbai to Manipur to Meghalaya, and we have got 1500 viewers right now logged in. There was some issue during in between your lectures, but we just sorted it out, and now everyone can see you live, and they have heard you also live. Thank you so much, sir. There are a few questions I would like to take.
Right.
Yeah. Sir, how reliable are ultrasound markers to predict the severity of anomalies?
Severity of anomalies?
Yes, sir. How reliable are these ultrasound markers?
Ultrasound markers, basically, they are either hard markers or soft markers.
Yes.
And when you talk about aneuploidy and soft markers to screen, they can pick up, but they cannot tell you the severity. So basically, all the markers are meant to pick up the congenital anomaly, but not for severity.
Very important point, sir. You have mentioned here that we will not be able to predict the severity, but of course, we can be nice enough to find out what are the anomalies which are there. Sir, in your talk, there is a question regarding what are the status of vitamin A supplementation, as I don't see it's being supplemented routinely. We are talking about B complex, multivitamins, we're talking about folic acid, but why vitamin A is not there?
No, as for the guideline by FDA, there is no need of giving any extra vitamin A to a pregnant woman. Okay? So, but there is a nice, as I had showed you, there's a medical evidence which is shown by so many workers in this field that the amount of folic acid, vitamin B12, B6, B10 in normal diet is not adequate, number one. And unless you give the active form, like 5-L-methylfolate, 5-P5P, cobalamin, you can't have this particular process going on in the woman. So directly you are giving a particular product whereby the folic acid or vitamin B12 or B6 doesn't have to go into conversion. So that is where the problem of polymorphism comes, and it can get blocked at the level of 5-10 methyl tetrahydrofolate. It does not become 5-tetrahydrofolate because of polymorphism by methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase enzyme. So that is where the importance of reducing homocysteinemia comes, because this blockage by methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase leads
you have given a wonderful lecture. Sir, your slides were very visual and they were very beautiful slides and nicely explained by you. It was so nice. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Dr. Yeah, Asma. Yeah. Sorry. I'm sorry, sir.
No, go ahead.
Thank you so much. Dr. Asma, as I said before, your knowledge is nothing less than the sky.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I want to ask you a question here. Cardiovascular anomalies have been reported to be associated with Coxsackie B3 and B4 infections during pregnancy. How can we understand this association and its prevention?
Well, it's a very interesting question. It's very rare. And certainly, it's not known to cause structural heart abnormalities. So, if you have a cardiac defect, VSDs, or the tragedy of fallot or something, it's not really known to be associated with congenital infection, including Coxsackie. It's something that's more when you have pericardial effusion or cardiomegaly. And therefore, that if you don't have any other explanation for that, you could test for it. But certainly, it's very rare that we will test for it, number one. Number two, we never test for it in structural heart abnormalities, which is a majority of the, you know, the heart abnormalities that you will deal with or you pick up during the pregnancy will be structural heart abnormalities. In this case, we don't. And to the best of my knowledge, Coxsackie does not necessarily cause structural heart abnormalities. It's more in pericardial effusion or cardiomegaly, for example.
Thank you. Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Asma, one more question is there. Does non-pregnant women with IgG positive for TORCH needs treatment before pregnancy?
For which TORCH? So I mean, obviously, TORCH is exclude different things, toxoplasma, CMV, rubella. But generally speaking, the answer is no, because IgG antibodies, the presence of IgG antibodies, means that you have been exposed to the infection in the past, and therefore, if anything, you're immune to it. So no, I think if anything, that's not a bad thing that you have the IgG antibodies. So no, it does not need any treatment or any further testing. If you ask about CMV infection, for example, because sometimes if a woman had a CMV, you know, there certainly commonly people would say wait for a year or maybe 6 months before attempting another pregnancy. But this is very much not really based on a strong evidence or a good quality evidence. And nowadays, I mean, I see these patients with my colleague who's a virologist and who's got special interest in CMV. And what he does is that he checks their IgG avidity. And when they reach a high avidity, he would actually say, well, I think it's reasonable to attempt another pregnancy now. So rather than just a blank, say, wait for a year, which is not really backed up by evidence, in this case, he checks the avidity of the IgG. But finding IgG positive pre-pregnancy does not necessarily mean anything or does not need any treatment. If anything, means that you've been exposed to it before.
Okay, thank you.
Can I add something?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, of course.
See, the only importance of IgG is whenever there is a reinfection or reactivation of the same viral infection. And if you see IgG rising by fourfold within 2 weeks' time, then only IgG becomes very significant. Otherwise, IgG positive is a good sign. That means the mother is already exposed to all these viruses and she has developed antibodies and she can fight this infection without any external treatment required.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for that expert comment. Sir, I come back to you now. The question is, what are the factors which are affecting risk of congenital malformations, especially if it is maternal diabetes?
Again, it's not only diabetes, but it is the hyperglycemia which is there circulating in the maternal blood. And that is what causes the imbalance. Number two, what is the age of the mother? Whether the diabetes is controlled or not. Whether she is on any anti-diabetic drugs or not. Whether she is exposed to any other teratogens. All these factors will definitely take a toll if she has to have a congenital anomaly.
Okay. Anything, Asma, you would like to add here? You would like to add something here?
No, I think his answer was perfect. So I've not got nothing to add.
No. I think, Niranjan, what is important is many times a patient conceives without knowing that she had diabetes. So if she has hyperglycemia during conception, periconception period, there is more likelihood of this particular patient getting congenital anomalies in later weeks of pregnancy. And that is the reason you must do HbA1c to find out what is the level. If it shows you high level beyond the normal, that it tells you that in last 3 months, she had uncontrolled diabetes. And if that is so, and if she gets pregnant, she has a very high chance of getting congenital malformations in later months of pregnancy.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Dr. Asma, there are two questions for you. The first one is congenital varicella syndrome. Can you explain again?
Yes, I mean, obviously because of the time that I had, I maybe went through it relatively quickly. But the congenital varicella is with, they have a number of abnormalities, and the one that we see in the fetus, they can be small, so be IGR, cross-restricted. They can have eye abnormalities, like for microphthalmia, for example. They can have limb abnormalities. They can have calcifications. And they can have ventricular megaly. So this is the things that you would look for when you follow up this pregnancy and doing ultrasound scan. So there would, this will be the abnormalities that you look for.
Thank you, Dr. Asma. One more question is from Dr. Asha Sachdeva. The pharma says the study of the interaction of folate metabolism and that of homocysteine methionine is particularly promising in congenital anomalies. What is your take? What is your take, Dr. Asma?
I think this question is wrong for question. Professor Shah, I think, is it?
I think wrong person has been asked the question. I agree.
Okay, Dr. P.K. Shah.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. Hyperhomocysteinemia and methionine, because if you have a control of this, normally we don't do these studies, let me tell you honestly, during pregnancy. We don't do any time folate level or methylcobalamin level, pyridoxine level, etc. at all. But always hyperhomocysteinemia is very dangerous. So it has various effects on the fetus and also on the mother also. So you have to have this particular thing kept in mind. The only way we manage these cases without knowing and going into the pathology and details is by giving, rather than folic acid, L-methyl folate, 5 milligram, methyl cobalamin instead of vitamin B12, 100 microgram daily, and same thing, vitamin B6, pyridoxal, 5 folate, that you can do during pregnancy. That is the best way you can avoid hyperhomocysteinemia and its adverse effects.
Okay. So that's what multifactorial birth defects are caused by, a combination of genes and environmental exposures. In other words, a person can inherit a gene that increases the sensitivity to an environmental trigger. Example, we have cleft lip, cleft palate, and certain heart defects, neural tube defects, and that's how we hear about them. So, we have got many questions lined up, but I think we are short of time. So, Dr. Asma, we will take the last question. This question is to Dr. Asma, ma'am. Is varicella vaccine in first trimester an absolute indication to terminate pregnancy, or do we have any option of continuing the pregnancy?
It's not an absolute indication for termination of the pregnancy. I mean, certainly in the UK, but it's also not, I mean, it's not something that women get in the first trimester either. And to some extent, most of us would have had varicella, so we don't test pregnant women whether they're immune to varicella or not. But in fact, when you do, when you test their booking bloods, the majority of them have been exposed already. So the majority of people are immune because they had chickenpox before. They might not remember, but it's not an absolute indication for termination of pregnancy.
Wonderful. I think we are at the end of the talk and the show. And people are really happy with the wonderful lectures which you have given. And I will appreciate the time which you both have given Dr. Asma Khalil from London. It's afternoon. I hope it's sunny. But in Mumbai, it's raining here. Yeah.
And it's lovely and sunny here today. It was raining the last 2 days. So I think the rain traveled from London to Mumbai.
Yes, yes. So when all open, when everything opens, we'll be surely calling you and Dr. Patrick O'Brien to join us to hear from him. And thank you, madam, for being there. Dr. P.K. Shah, sir, yes. It was a wonderful talk which you have given, especially a senior expert like you giving a talk. And again, you have a webinar at 9:30. Thank you for your wonderful enlightenment of knowledge. TOG has witnessed the best of science discussions, and we thank you wholeheartedly for your time today. It's very important that I would like to end this talk with a paragraph from Lana Raffaella. She says, "I think it's brave that you get up in the morning, even if your soul is weary and your bones ache for a rest. I think it's brave that you keep on living, even if you don't know how to anymore. I think it's brave that you push away the waves which are rolling in every day and you decide to fight yet again. I know these days when you feel like giving up, but I think it's brave that you never do." So I would like to thank all the corona warriors which have been there with us and are fighting this COVID war pandemic all over the world. It is these warriors for their magnanimity which they showcase their selfless service to mankind. And I thank all of you to join today. Please take care. Be safe. Shabba Khair. Shubh Ratri. Vadakkam. And we will meet very, very soon with one more international faculty joining. Till then, have a nice weekend. On behalf of Science Integra, TOG, Aristo Pharma, and Foxy Medical Disorders and Pregnancy, I, Dr. Niranjan Chavan, takes a bow in front of all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Niranjan.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, sir.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.